Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the BAME-OT UK podcast channel. My name is Sherelle Tayson, and I'm here with
Joe Brissiando. And today we're here to discuss the book called The Mysteries of the Golden Stool that has been written by Mr. Ernest Insia Youngman. Ernest, can you give us a
Hello.
little bit of info? Hello. Can you give us a little bit of information about yourself and who you are?
Well, as you called me, my name is Ernest Insia Youngman. I would say I'll start from the last thing I did. I'm the author of The Mysteries of the Golden Stool, and I'm a filmmaker, an actor, both on stage and on screen. I write for stage and screen as well. Not a big time writer, but I write a little bit of it. And I also do film production in Ghana. And then I also have been the personal aide to the former president Kufuor as his personal archivist for the period that he was in president. In fact, I started working for him before he became president. And that's perhaps a little bit I can say about myself for now.
Thank you for that.
Thank you, Ernest. So I'm going to go straight in with some questions to give us a bit more insight on the book. So, first question, why should people know about the story of the Golden Stool?
The first thing is that most often, in fact, the history of Ghana and particularly the Asantes had always been something that a lot of people, particularly Ghanaians, don't pay attention to ourselves. We don't, because we think we know it. It's been written by mostly people who are not Asantes Ghanaians, and particularly by the Europeans who came here. And they wrote it in a way that will suit them, that will help them look good. Because I give one classic example. They look at Africans, the Europeans look at Africans and call them savages. Why? I sit on my land, you come, you want to take my land. I fight you, you kill me, I kill you, then you call me savage. That is one twist of it. So there has come a time that we must make conscious effort to tell our African stories or Ghanaian stories ourselves in a way that will put us in better light. Our stories are true. Our stories are unique. But unfortunately, because we don't project it ourselves, like the saying goes, if the lions don't tell their stories, the hunter will always say it the way that it will favor him. So we must say our stories the way that we think we project our Africanness. That is one of the reasons why I wanted to write the book. The other reason is also the there came a time in Ghana, sometime around the late 80s towards the early 90s, when video movies started in Ghana, and particularly in West Africa. Ghana and Nigeria, we all started together. And at that time, most of the stories that everybody will see on screen were stories written about witches, ghosts, and terrible mother-in-laws. But I was like, is that the best way of projecting our country? Because film is the best medium to export the culture, tradition, and way of life of a people. You watch Indian films, we see how they're projecting their culture through their films. You watch American films, any other, the Chinese or even Japanese, they have their peculiar tradition that they want people to see. Was it ours that witches and witchcrafts and people exorcising the devil from people, is that what we want people to know of us? We have such a rich history. Why don't we tell our history? So I looked for something that the world will acknowledge as a commodity that everybody would like to see. A group of people that has good history that everybody will want to hear. And when you put the two together, gold is very precious. And if you're talking about gold, people, it will attract people's attention. If you're talking about culture in Ghana, the best exhibitor of culture in Ghana is Asante. But then the unique thing that joined the two of them is the golden stool. So let's see how we can tell a story about the golden stool and tell our history at the same time. So I chose a very simple scenario where the British at one time wanted to steal the golden stool or take away the golden stool from the Asantes from the early 1800 towards 1900, almost 100 years, where they fought almost about six wars so that they can take control of the West African area where Ghana is now. Now, Asantes resisted them. So if they decided to take the golden stool, did they get it? No. If they didn't get it, then where is it? Now, my story begins from here. Although it's a fiction, it has a lot of history, culture, tradition, and a lot of education for young people who don't know much about our Asante history to learn. So I decided that let me find how we can still bring this golden stool back and the Asante culture back to our people in a very, very entertaining way. Not a textbook, but you read a story that will entertain you, but at the same time will give you a lot of information. So I chose that scenario of people who think they are better owners of the golden stool and now want to come and dispossess the ascendants of the golden stool. That is the base of the book.
Wow,
that's
really interesting. Yeah, it sounds really interesting.
Yes.
Yeah, and you know, myself and Joe being two fellow Ghanaian women as well, for myself being born here, it's really interesting because I used to hear about the golden stool growing up, but not in depth. So a book like this is something that would help, you know, children who are or people who are born in Western countries but have an African heritage. So yes, thank you for writing such a book.
And if I may add, for people like you, it serves a good form of information and education.
Yeah.
In fact, my target audience has always been the young adults, from young adults to all African people of African descent, so that they can relate. Mm-hmm. And when they know our history, they can tell it everywhere and hold their heads and themselves high in their, among their peers wherever they go. Unfortunately, young people in young Africans or people of African descent living outside Africa, particularly in Europe and America, don't really try to get themselves to know much of our culture. But I thought if I put this one, it would attract them in a way that would let them start searching for more information about Africa.
Mm. That's good. Ernest, can I quickly ask for anybody who's going to be watching this, what's the significance of the golden stool to the Ashanti people?
Okay. The Ashanti kingdom was created around the golden stool. If I may give an example, like the Ark of Covenant that the people of Israel in the Bible seem to be associated with, and hold in high esteem as a power of God to protect them.
Mm-hmm.
The Asante also see the golden stool as such. In fact, they have a trinity, the golden stool, the king, and the kingdom. These are the three things that any Asante person holds in high esteem. Respect for the king, The respect for the resistance and the power and control of the golden stool and the nation Asante. If you don't respect the three, you cannot be considered as an Asante man. And any time, even the Asantes, in fact, they look at the king as their God. They call him God. Osei, Osei tu e nyame. Jose Tutu, you are God. And that's how they look at it. Every religion is ancestral worship. Every religion. Because they look at somebody who came before and later on someone who followed after. Relatives. If you take Christianity, there are saints, people look to them. And if you look at it, the genealogy of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and all that, Christians look at it from that source. So do their scientists also hold their ancestry as very, very important. So they use the golden stool as a medium of contact with the ancestors. Because the golden stool, as I said from the beginning, is the power around which the kingdom was formed. And it has held its power and strength through that anyone who sits on it, or anyone who occupies it, or anyone who becomes the custodian of the golden stool, becomes that golden stool and becomes that power. And through whom the people of Asante pass their messages from themselves to their ancestors and their spiritual powers that protect them. So that is where the focus of the golden stool is.
Thank you.
That's so interesting. Really, really interesting. Ernest, another question I have for you. So as well as the book about the mysteries of the golden stool, is there anything else that you want to write about, or is there anything in the works that you're planning to come up with?
The Ashanti's history is so wide and big and diverse in such a way that what I have in the Mysteries of the Golden School, I can say it's just a scratch. Yes, somebody wants to try to steal the Golden School. What about the wars, the occupation, the expansionism of Ashanti Kingdom? Where was Osei-Tutu the first before he became a king? What happened? The war of liberation that the Ashantis fought against the Dentras. So you can see that there's so much that we haven't talked about in the Ashanti history, and so much that people don't know. Even the people, as I said, who live as Ashantis know almost everything, but they don't talk, they don't say it. So the Mystery of the Golden Stool is just a beginning of a series of stories that I want to find a way of writing Ashanti history, more or less, not covered, but enhanced with stories and anecdotes like what I have in the Mission of the Golden Stool, so that people will, by reading the stories, will, as I said, find some reason why they should not go to research about what the Golden Stool stands for to the Ashantis, the significance, the importance. How do they celebrate it? How many times do they celebrate it? You know, the Ashantis have their own calendar. It runs for 6 weeks, from Sunday to Monday. Not from Monday to Sunday, from Sunday to Monday. Sorry, Sunday to Saturday. From Sunday to Saturday. That is how the Ashanti calendar is. Now, it repeats itself for 6 weeks. And at the end of the 6 weeks, the golden stool is celebrated. That is what the Ashantis call the Akwesitae. That is when they go into the two rooms and go and pour or make libation, call on the ancestors, seek their presence and protection, and ask them to help for the nation to grow, for more food, for health and life. That's what they do every time they go to the stool. That's what they ask for. So if you look at the Ashanti Kingdom from Osei-Tutu the first, there have been about 16 kings so far. The current one who is sitting on it is the 16th king. And every king has ancestry that we have to link, they have to be linked to, for the spirits of the ancestors to come and protect the people. So if you're looking at it from that angle, how many stories would you write for Osei-Tutu the first alone? Or the next Opoku-Ware? Or even come closer, Prepare the first, the years that he spent in Seychelles Island, or probably the second Opokuware, the kind of work that Osetutu the second is doing now, it cannot even be contained in one book. So there's so much that we will have to write about the stories, that this is just the beginning. And I hope that, of course, people like you and your intervention will let will give me the motivation to want to pursue the full agenda as I have planned for myself, to try and tell the Asante story in a way that everybody will appreciate.
Thank you. Thank you, Ernest. It's just such rich wealth in the stories that you're saying, and I can't wait to see the series of books that you have coming up. And I'm sure myself and Joe and other fellow Ghanaians around the world will be, you know, pushing for you to continue to tell stories about our heritage, because it's very much appreciated, honestly.
Thank you.
I wanted to ask, so if anyone wanted to discuss with you a bit more about the book, or just to get in touch with you, like how do they get to contact you?
Okay. I'm almost available anytime. I'm on social media. Apart from my name, Ernest Insia Youngman, I'm also known as Kofi Young on all the social media platforms. Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, or is it X, Instagram? I'm all there. I'm working on my own website, which is still not up yet. I started it and we couldn't get it working properly, so I asked them to hold on. As soon as it's ready, we would want to put it up so that we'll have more information, so that we can also get people coming in for a lot more interaction like we're doing now. Definitely, as I said, if you just write Kofi, which is Kofi Young, Young, or Kofyoung. These are the three handles that you can get me on social media. My full name and a sincere young man, Kofi Young, or Kofi Young. Or even type the book, the title of the book, Mysteries of the Golden Stone. You get a lot more information about me, and perhaps it will link you with to other social media platforms that I may be engaged in every now and then.
Thank you. Thank you, Ernest. Thank you so much. I think this podcast, it links in really well with Black History Month. As they say, it's in October. But as we have discussed before, as BAMOT UK, that Black History goes on all year round for us. So this book is really going to tie in very well with the whole Black History. So thank you so much, Ernest.
Yeah, but before we wrap up, I wanted to say this from the beginning, but just escaped me, that the original story was written for a movie.
Wow.
It was written for a movie. I can say that the manuscript, the screenplay manuscript, is still available, right, out of which the book was written. Now, the hope is that we'll be able to finish the movie as soon as we can. It requires a lot of money too. So maybe, I don't know whether Joe and Sharon, you have, they're not a Bank of England, but
some contacts,
that's somewhere we can look at. Definitely, if we are able to start something, imagine we're running some series like Game of Thrones, even like that. You can imagine the amount of stories I will be able to tell about the might of the Asante Kingdom, the expansions, the wars with other ethnic groups around, how they built the nation, how they brought people together, how they have built themselves up to now.
Yeah.
We can have a lot more to tell the world.
Okay. So yes. If there's any investors out there interested in helping Ernest get this story to film, contact us, BAME OT or Ernest directly, because I think it's definitely a film or a series that I would want to watch. So, let's all pull together and see if we can get this made and say that we contributed to, getting our history out there.
That's right.
Yeah.
And
Okay.
thank you also very much for giving me this opportunity to tell my story to the world. And the book is also available on Amazon. You can buy a copy from there. I also have a Kindle read for free up there. You can go online and read free if you don't want to buy, or you just want to read. Just worry, you can read a whole book free online by downloading Amazon Kindle, and the books are available. Or if you want me to send you an autograph copy, just hit me, and then we'll make the necessary arrangements, and I'll make sure I can find you anywhere in the world and send you a copy. That I can assure you.
Okay. That's
Yes.
very generous, Ernest. I think you should be charging, though. If we're going to get this film made, you need to be strict about getting the funds
To
in.
get more money in.
That's right.
Oh, Ernest, just quickly, just to follow up about what you asked about the movie. So once the manuscript is finished and everything, what kind of actors have you thought about, actors or actresses that you would like to come in,
I'm
star
looking
and
at
be a co-
a blend of local and international actors. I want, of course, every film requires a particular kind of cast or actors to drive the market. It also requires good production crew to also enhance the quality. So definitely, I have that in mind. That's why when I ask someone to assess the film and give me an estimate as to how much it's costing to do a film like that, he gave me a price that scared me. That I said, then let's see how we can start some process to see if we'll be able to generate. And there's a lot more that we have to do, particularly trying to put the script in a more acceptable to the big producers' appreciation. Maybe what I've done may be good for me, but perhaps if I may meet somebody like Idris Elba or Spielberg, who wants to do this movie, they may want it in a different way. So I need to find a way of enhancing the presentation, way to make the kind of appreciation to whoever wants to produce it. So that's where we have to look at, and I think we have to go one step at a time. I'm hoping that within the next few months, we should be able to put the script together as a good blueprint, so that when you put it on anybody's desk, it will be able to keep your attention. In fact, the book in itself is one other marketing tool that everybody who wants, at least you have something to read to understand what the story is. If I was holding the manuscript, perhaps you may not have heard about me. But when I turned the story into a storybook, definitely it has had some form of movement, and now it's reaching other people for them to notice that there's something like that available.
That's good. Ernest, can I ask whether Sherelle and I can be extras in the film? Maybe we could be in the village, pounding fufu.
Why do you think that you are not qualified to become lead characters?
Wow. I'm not sure if I've got the acting skills for
Well,
that.
film, you need to, you once you have the edge and you want to be part of it, definitely there will be a role for everybody. In fact, there is a scene or there's a period where it will require quite a crowd. The chapter 17 of the book, which vividly explains or narrates how the Akwasida Festival is celebrated and involves a lot of people. And if we're shooting a scene like that, where we'll have several troops of paramount chiefs and their queen mothers and their attendants coming through like a carnival. You can imagine a carnival like that and so many people coming. Definitely, there will be room for a lot more people to come and play roles like that. I'm looking at the local Ghanaian actors and actresses and also looking at international actors. In fact, if I may say that I had an eye on Idris Elba to play the lead role.
Wow.
Long before.
Okay. Idris,
yes.
If you're watching.
And I'm trying, I'm making inroads to see if I can have audience with him, for at least to listen to me and see if I have something for him to look at. Definitely, I'm also looking at, at one time, I was also even looking at, because there's more expatriate or Caucasian cast also as part of it that we will need. It's a mixture of a lot of ethnic groups from all over the world, the Chinese or Eastern or Asian, South American or Mexican. You have African Americans, we have Africans, Ghanaians. So there are a lot of other roles that many of you can get roles to play. So definitely.
That sounds
but as I said, we can go one step at a time.
Yeah.
We might not necessarily want to scare anybody. But if there's anyone who is interested for us to start the small ones for it to grow, I'm available. We can start it from small, finishing the manuscript, and then we'll look at the marketing from there gradually as we're going.
Wow.
Not in millions now, but at least a few thousands will not be bad if we should start from now.
Oh wow. Ernest, thank you so much for your time. We've got to wrap it up there. I wish you luck with getting in contact with Idris. So Idris, if you're watching, you know, please contact Ernest. We want to see this film produced. We wish you all the best. And
thank you.
As we like to do on BAME-OT UK on the podcast, we often like to wrap up with a little quote that maybe sums up what we've been talking about. And so the one we've got today is actually by the historian, the Black British historian, David Olusoghun, which I'm sure many people would have heard of. And what he has said is that time and again, events and phenomena that we think we know and understand contain within them lost or camouflaged connections to Africa, slavery and Black history. And I think, as Ernest so eloquently has discussed this afternoon, that's where, you know, the mysteries of the golden stool are now being revealed, and we're seeing the truth behind, you know, what has originally gone on and Britain's connection to that. So we hope, Sherelle and I hope that you've enjoyed watching this podcast today. Ernest, we thank you so much for your time. And guys, we'll be back soon, and watch out for our next podcast.